Before I hand out the notes, let's do a little introduction and talk about a couple of statements. In fact, I'm going to make mention of two statements, and these two statements are contradictory one of another. And what I want you to do is tell me which one you believe to be the truth. Okay? So here's the first one. Flattery will get you nowhere. There's the first one. The second one is the exact opposite. Flattery will get you everywhere. Which one of those two statements do you believe to be true? The first one. Flattery will get you nowhere. Why do you say that? Okay. And do you say that because that's the way you feel about it when it's given to you? Okay, very good. Jeannie? Okay, Emily? Okay, then we're getting into a whole other realm, a different realm when it becomes sincere and true. Okay, Gail, you're back there not believing any of this. What do you think? let me read you a statement. Okay, the second statement seems to contain the truth. Flattery works. People love to be praised, held in high esteem, and have their egos stroked. People love that stuff, folks. You know what? They love it. There are many individuals in our society who thrive on that kind of stuff. And if you become the flatterer, guess what? Flattery has its rewards. Do you know that? In some circles, flattery has a ton of rewards as far as on this earth that are given to you. Julie, what were you going to say? Well, there's no doubt about that. Okay, no doubt about that. Okay, Hal? Sounds like experience speaking to me. Hi, Glenn.
I hope Catherine Ford doesn't get angry at me, but on her way in, she's talking about Brad Powell, and she said that Brad Powell calls her every other day. She said,
But now, see, in a minute, we're going to get to a distinction between flattery and something else, okay? And what we're going to do tonight, believe it or not, we're still talking about taming the tongue, okay? And the Bible has a lot to say about flattery, okay? A lot to say about flattery. In fact, there's about 35 or 36 verses that mention that particular term, or at least are associated with that kind of behavior, okay? And so we're going to talk about it under the title of this, Thank You. Will you tell me that again? Okay, because sometimes we just love what? We just love to hear somebody say something good about us, don't we? You know, and it just kind of, ooh, it rubs us good, and we just kind of like that. And so I'll get a couple of folks to hand out the notes, and we'll go through this and talk about it tonight. All righty. First thing I want to do is I want to go through the scripture or a few passages of scripture that talk about flattery, okay? And as we consider these passages, I want you to see if the Bible talks about it favorably or if the Bible talks about flattery in a negative way, okay? So the first passage we'll look at is Psalm 5, verse 9. Here's what it says. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher. They flatter with their tongue. Wow. Now, if we had just removed the last statement, they flatter with their tongue, would we know whether or not flattery is evil or good? You really wouldn't know, would you? You know, they flatter with their tongue. Okay, flattery goes on all the time, doesn't it? Flattery happens all the time. People kind of flirt with one another using what? Using flattery, okay? Bosses oftentimes kind of flatter their employees to motivate them and to get them to do a little bit extra, a little bit more, okay? So flattery is something that happens all the time. But notice the context in which this particular statement is made. Notice those other statements that are there. There is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher. And then he concludes with what? They flatter with their tongue. So does that put flattery in the realm of being good or in the realm of being evil? Evil. Okay? Let's look at another passage. Proverbs 7:21. With her much fair speech, she caused him to yield. With the flattering of her lips, she forced him. Okay, that's Proverbs chapter 7. Anybody know the context out of which that verse comes? Yeah, the strange woman, okay? The prostitute, the one who is out there trying to seduce an individual, a young man. And Solomon is writing to warn him about this woman. And notice what he says. He says, this woman does what? With the flattering of her lips, she what? She forces him, okay? Ooh, you are a handsome devil. Okay. Ooh, look at those muscles. Okay. You are one of the kindest, sweetest men I've ever known. And I love your little Toyota. And all of a sudden, this guy, what? Ooh, man. This woman's interested in me. She likes me. She thinks I'm good looking. And guess what? All she's doing is using flattering lips to what? To seduce. Again, is that in the context of good or evil? It's in the context of evil, folks. Let's look at another passage. 1 Thessalonians 2:5. The Apostle Paul is talking on this particular occasion. He's talking to the Thessalonians and he says this, "For neither at any time used we flattering words, as ye know, nor a cloak of covetousness. God is witness." Paul says, we have never used flattering words. Okay? Purpose of the preacher is not to what? Not to flatter you. Okay? It's not the purpose of a gospel preacher. That's not the purpose of the gospel message, to flatter us. Okay? And do we have a lot of preachers today who have turned what they call the gospel into sheer flattery? Oh, yeah. Okay? One individual said that one of the biggest pieces of flattery ever used on mankind was Satan in the Garden of Eden. Ye shall be as gods. Ooh, I can be a god? Thank you. Okay, flattery. Did it work? Yeah. But Paul said, we have not used what? Flattery among you. You see, Paul knew flattery is what? Flattery is evil. Okay, and that's not the way to entice people and bring people to the gospel of Christ. Notice what Job said. He that speaketh flattery to his friends, even the eyes of his children shall fail. Wow. That's pretty powerful. And does that make flattery good or bad? It's bad again. Notice Proverbs chapter 29, verse 5. A man that flattereth his neighbor spreadeth a net for his feet. Good or bad? Bad. Guys, every time that flattery is used in Scripture, it is always in an evil, negative, bad context. Never once does the Bible authorize the use of flattery even for good purposes. Isn't that something? Flattery is not a good thing. Okay, Larry?
Isn't it encouraging us to tell it like it is?
Tell it like it is. Absolutely. And that's what Scripture says. Now, we're going to come back to, like I said, there's an area that I can just, everybody goes, you mean I can never say anything good about anybody? Okay, that's the way you start thinking. Okay, you mean I can't, well, that ain't true, preacher. I'm going to do it anyway. Okay, well, you just die and go to hell. Okay, no, I'm kidding. There's a whole other area that we really need to consider, and we will as we get toward the end of the lesson. It's interesting. Let's look down. That's the very next point, the definition of flattery. In the Old Testament, the word flattery is used numerous times, okay? I've only given you five examples of Scripture, four from the Old Testament. And in every instance, the words are a little bit different, but only because of the prefixes or the endings, okay? The root word is always the same, and the root word means smooth. Okay, smooth. That's what it means in every place. When you look down, however, at Brown, Driver, and Briggs, notice how they define it. To be smooth, slippery, what's that next word? Deceitful. Okay? It's smooth talk for a what? For a deceitful end. Okay, that's what flattery is. Smooth talk for a deceitful end, okay? I don't want my wife to get upset with me, so what do? I just flatter her, you know? And so, you know, there's an end in it when it comes to flattery, okay? Notice the New Testament. The New Testament word for flattery carries the exact same definition, folks. Strong and Thayer says that it means smooth, okay? Strong says a fawner. I had to look up that word. Okay, one who, have you ever heard that? Oh, he's just fawning over that individual. Have you ever heard that before? What does it mean? He just fawn, huh? Oohing and ah, yeah, oohing and ah. Boy, I hadn't heard those words in a long time, you know. Oohing and ahing over a person. Ooh, ah, you know, and just fawning over them. Notice the definition. A fawner is one who seeks attention and admiration from cringing and flattery. Here's the way the dictionary defines it. Flattery is defined as excessive, insincere praise. Okay? Excessive, insincere praise. Notice D. I have heard flattery defined as this: laying it on thick. You ever heard that? You know? Man, guys, sometimes in preacher circles, this is terrible, okay? A preacher goes to preach at a congregation, you know, and the other preacher knows him well, and guess what he does? He just gets up there and just lays it on thick, you know? And I've been to lectureships where one preacher introduces another preacher, and man, it may take him 5 minutes to introduce this dude, you know? There ain't nobody. It takes 5 minutes to introduce, you know? Nobody takes that long to introduce. And yet, boy, they're just slobbering all over him, you know, and that's the other definition that I have, slobbering all over another person. You know, just saying all this stuff to do what? Build him up, getting his good graces. That's what flattery is, okay? Now, there are numerous examples of flattery in Scripture, okay? One of them is found in Acts, the 12th chapter, a man by the name of Herod, okay? Oh, Herod comes out and he's dressed to the hilt. And he makes this great oration unto the people. And the people begin to do what? Flattery with their words. Notice what the text says. And upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. And the people gave a shout, saying, It is the voice of a God, not of a man. And guess what he did? He just ate it up, didn't he? And guess what happened? He got it up, didn't he? Very next verse says that God sent a plague upon him and worms ate the man, folks. Okay, again, flattery is what? Evil in nature. Okay? Now, I find it interesting in the Old Testament, you have these kings. Okay? In Israel, there were 19 kings. Every one of them were evil. Okay? Not one good king in the northern kingdom. All right? In the southern kingdom, they had 19 kings, and all of them but four or five, and the four or five have some questions about them, okay, at least two of them. But four or five of them were righteous, at least partially so, okay? But the rest of them were all what? Evil. Well, when you're this big man and you know, you don't want to have any criticism. You circle yourself with all of these what? Yes men. That's right. That's what we call them. Yes men. Okay. Guess what they are? They were flatterers. Okay. Now, there was a king by the name of Ahab, and he surrounded himself with yes men, flatterers. They are referred to as prophets. Okay. Now, if a king's going to battle, guess what he wants to know? Or am I going to win? So guess what he would do? Consult with his flatterers, right? Now, do you think any person wants to tell the king, King, if you go out there on this particular mission, you're going to die? You think that's what he wants to hear? No, what does he want to hear? Yeah, everything's good. You're going to win. Just go on out there. The battle's yours. Well, guess what? Oh, Ahab had a whole host of people that were that way. And we see an example of it in 2 Kings 22:6. Then the king of Israel gathered the prophets together, about 400 men. See, I told you some people love what? Love to be flattered, not just by one, 400 flatterers. And said unto them, shall I go against Ramoth-Gilead to battle? Or shall I forbear? And they said, go up, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. Go on up. You go home tonight and you read the rest of that chapter, folks. Okay? Because there is a prophet of God that is called to tell the truth. Ahab is going into battle with the king of Judah as well. Okay. Well, the king of Judah, when he hears all these false prophets saying, oh yeah, go, you're going to win, guess what? He's not too comfortable with that. So he asked them, is there not another prophet? And guess what? There is. And he's in prison because Ahab hates him. You want to know why? Ahab says, because he never prophesies anything good about me. Okay. Just go home and read the text. Okay. He is even encouraged to prophesy positively to Ahab. Okay, he's even encouraged to do that. And you'll find an interesting story there. It's just good. Okay, note this next one. It is possible for a person to flatter who? Himself. Wow. Okay. I don't need flatterers. Guess why I don't need any? Because I do a good job myself. And the Bible talks about them. Look at it. Psalm 36, verse 2. For he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be found to be hateful. He flattereth himself with what? His own eyes. Okay? That's it. Bad, isn't it? Oh, Nebuchadnezzar had the big head, didn't he? Notice what it says about Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel chapter 4, verse 29 beginning. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spake and said, Is not this great Babylon that, what? I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty. I have built this. My power, my majesty has made all of this available. Just flattering what? Flattering themselves. I don't know about you, but I'm about sick of the television, you know? Because it doesn't matter what you watch just about. Guess what? Everybody wants to flatter who? Themselves. Don't they? We're great. We're powerful. Without us, you'd be bored. You'd be bad off. You couldn't make it. You couldn't handle it. It's just unbelievable. And it doesn't matter who it is, does it? I mean, all the way from the top down, these individuals think that they are God's gift to the universe. And they just flatter themselves. You know? Guys, we're all just what? We're just dust, aren't we? And guess what? We're all going to return to what? Dust. Okay? So we have to be very careful about this flattery. Now notice point four. Why do people flatter others? Okay? I've just got two reasons down there. Okay? Number one, they flatter others in order to get in their good graces. Okay? I read a pretty good little story, though. There was a bully of a guy, and it was Steven Spielberg. In fact, he said when he was in either junior high or high school, there was a bully just constantly picking on him every day, every day. Well, Steven Spielberg, at a young age, knew that he wanted to be a movie director. Okay? So one day that bully came up to him and he's about to bully him again, and Steven Spielberg, he started flattering him. He said, "You want to know what? You are a muscular dude. You remind me a lot of John Wayne. And you know what? If you will do what you need to do, one of these days I'm going to put you in one of my movies and you can just play the part of that good, strong, powerful guy." And guess what? Never bullying again. Because he what? He flattered him. Okay? He just flattered him. Unbelievable. Okay? So I guess if you're about to get whooped up on, flatter him, man. Notice the next one. In order to manipulate people and circumstances in their favor. That's exactly what Spielberg did, didn't he? Sometimes we flatter people in order to get a promotion. Sometimes we flatter people in order to get a raise. Sometimes we flatter individuals in order to get them to do things that we want them to do. Okay? It's just amazing that some people will almost go out of their way, bend over and almost break because somebody will do what to them? Flatter them. Another person comes along, okay, make the same request, but no flattery, and guess what? Just go your little way. Okay? But see, all really the flatterer is doing nothing more than what? Manipulating you to get what he wants out of you. And that's dangerous, folks. Okay? Very, very dangerous. Okay? Questions, comments? Yes, ma'am. He at least made false promises to him for certain. Okay, I don't know that he flattered him per se from the standpoint of you're great, you're wonderful, you know, but he did say, "I'll give you all these kingdoms." Yeah, yeah. He was trying to manipulate him. There's no doubt about that. But not, I don't know that he was necessarily manipulating him through flattery, okay? Through a false promise of what I'll give you. Yeah, he definitely did that. Notice point five, flattery's evil connections. Flattery's evil connections. Number one, flattery is connected to lying. Psalm 78, verse 36. "Nevertheless, they did flatter him with their mouth, and they lied unto him with their what? With their tongue." Okay? Now, it may be that what the flatterer says has some truth to it. Right? Okay? May have some truth to it. Why does it become a lie if it has some truth to it then? It's not the whole truth, okay? Or it is exaggerated truth, right? You know, building up somebody a lot more than they really are, okay? I hate when I go to a place where I've never preached before, okay? And the preacher knows me, and he goes in there and he starts making all these promises, you know. Oh, you're going to like Vic, you're going to, oh, blah, 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 blah. Man, just hush. Let me get in there and let them like me or hate me based on what I do, you know. Don't make them a liar out of him, you know. But we can easily lie to individuals about their being better than they are, prettier than they are, greater than they are, whatever it is, just to do what? Just to flatter them. Ah, that's pretty good, isn't it? That's pretty good. Wow. Notice this next one. Flattery is connected to a double heart. They speak vanity, everyone with his neighbor. With flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak. Why does he say that flattery and a double heart go together? Ah. You know, most people know truth when they see it, okay? I mean, God has given us the ability to recognize truth, folks, okay? And when we go beyond that, right? Here's the truth, but I'm going to step beyond it. Well, then, guess what? I've got a double heart, don't I? I know what the truth is about this person, but what am I going to do? I'm going to make it excessive. Oh, he's even gooder than what I'm telling you. Okay, he's just wonderful. Okay, and so you just build him up and make him something, and you really know the truth. Okay, you know that here's where he really is, but I'm going to build him up to be up here. Okay, a double heart. Okay, very interesting. Flattery is also connected to evil people, and we've already talked about that. Proverbs 6, verse 24 is another passage about the strange woman. To keep thee from the evil one, from the flattery of the tongue of a strange woman. Flattery is connected to ruin, Proverbs 26, verse 28. A lying tongue hateth those that are afflicted by it, and a flattering mouth worketh ruin. We're going to come back to that when we get to the conclusion, okay? I want you to see this next point. This is pretty interesting, okay? Folks, flattery is also closely connected to Satan and hell, okay? You cannot read your Bible without coming away with an understanding that flattery is always evil. Okay? Every time it's evil. And individuals have looked at flattery and they know that it's bad. And so what they've done is they've shown us how bad it is in some of their writings. Okay? Anybody ever heard of Dante? An author? What did he write? The Inferno. Talking about the what? The circles of hell into which a person can go. Okay? The eighth circle. You don't want to go there. Okay? You just don't want to go there. It's nasty. Okay? If you don't believe it, read that statement. Dante depicts flatterers waiting in human excrement. If you don't know what that is, you go home and look it up. Stating that their words were equivalent to excrement. The eighth circle of hell. Man, that's pretty nasty, isn't it? He's trying to get us to understand how grotesque flattery is, folks. Okay? That's what he's trying to do. And he uses, you know, the worst possible thing he can think of to show persons walking around in it. And guys, you know, when you flatter, you're just walking around in human excrement. That's just gross. So he's trying to show how bad it is. And that's where individuals, and again, Dante's Inferno is a fictitious book, but it's interesting that he puts it in hell. This next statement comes from a man by the name of LaVey. Anton LaVey. Has anybody ever heard of Anton LaVey? Nobody's ever heard of him. Wow, I thought somebody might have heard of him. Okay, he is the founder of the Satanic Church. Okay? He wrote the Satanic Bible. Okay, that is a real group. Okay, I'm not kidding. It is a real group. He wrote a second book entitled Satan Speaks. Okay? And this quote comes from that book. And I want you to listen to what he says. Oh, how I... What does he say? Lie. Remember we said flattery is always connected to what? To lie. Okay, folks, it's a lie. It's not the truth. Okay, an exaggeration of the truth or no truth at all, but it's connected to lying. If a fellow be a currish lout, I tell him how sensitive and discriminating he is. If a girl is so ugly that she must sneak up on a glass of water, I allude to her beauty. If one's performance is mediocre at best, I applaud his great talent. I praise the skinflint on his generosity and the hysteric on his level-headed judiciousness. What's he doing? He's flattering people who have nothing to be flattered about, right? Okay, here's an ugly girl, and what does he tell her? Ooh, you're a beauty. You're just gorgeous. Okay? Here's an old stingy old guy, wouldn't give money to anything, and guess what he says? Ooh, you're the most generous guy who ever walked the face of the earth. Notice what he says in that last statement. And it makes them all what? Feel good. And folks, you want to know why mega churches can fill mega churches with tens of thousands of people? Because they walk out feeling good. You know that? Feel wonderful. Feel wonderful. You walk into our services, and the minute you bring a visitor, old Vic's got to preach on hell. Or he's got to preach on denominationalism. Right? Or he's got to preach on marriage, divorce, and remarriage. I don't know why you preach on that, but I got visitors here today. Well, what you want me to do? Make them feel good? Yeah. We want them to come back. You see, that's the mindset of our nation today. Okay? Build everybody up, make everybody feel good, and never say anything what? Negative or bad about anybody. Okay? Now, I've done a lot of talk about what? Now, flattery. Okay? But I told you, there is another category, folks, of speech that we need to consider, and it's okay to do this, and it's called a compliment. Okay? A compliment is totally the opposite of a flattery. Okay? True or false? Jesus complimented many people. There's at least 6 or 7 times that you read of Jesus complimenting certain people. Okay? You turn over in John 1 verse 47 and old Nathanael comes to Jesus and Jesus looks at Nathanael and he says this, "Behold, an Israelite indeed." And then he says this, "In whom there is what? No guile." What is that, folks? In whom there is no, what is guile? No what? Nothing false, nothing evil, nothing wicked, an upright, sincere, honest individual. That Jesus just complimented that man. In whom there is no guile. Okay? So a compliment. After the death of John, Jesus was talking to his disciples, and guess what he told them? As far as prophets go, there hath none risen greater than John. Pretty big compliment, isn't it? I mean, had there been a lot of prophets in times past? Yeah, we're talking about Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, okay? Great prophets of old. And here Jesus is, John is the greatest of them all. Folks, that's a compliment, isn't it? Notice what he says about the disciples. I mean, told the disciples about the centurion. I've not found so great faith. No, not what? Not in Israel. A man of great faith. He said of the woman who washed his feet with her hair, for she loved what? Much. A compliment. Jesus affirmed that Mary hath chosen that good part. And I don't know about you, when I stand before Jesus in judgment, I hope He compliments me. Don't you? Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Folks, that's a compliment. Okay, it's not flattery. None of these statements are flattery. It's a compliment. Okay? Same thing. Yeah. Now, look at the contrast between flattery and compliments. Okay? Flattery is insincere. A compliment is sincere. Okay? Number two. Flattery is an exaggeration of truth or no truth. A compliment is always the truth. Flattery has a hidden agenda, maybe to win favor of the individual. A compliment has no agenda at all. When I make this statement to you, I get no what? No reward whatsoever. In fact, it may be that I put you before me because of that. So no agenda whatsoever. Notice the next one. Flattery is drawn out. Like I told you, I've heard introductions of preachers, and they go for 5 minutes. And by the time you get through, you're just going, this is nasty, you know. One man said, what do you want me to say about you, preacher? And I said, you just tell them that I'm a gospel preacher. That's all they need to know. Isn't that true? What else do you need to know about a man, you know? Got to write out these, you know, 5-paragraph things about how great and wonderful you are. Oh, just drives me insane. You know, I will tell you, I got 6 grandkids, though. Notice the next one. It's done often. A compliment's given occasionally. Flattery puffs up. A compliment builds up. Flattery is showy. A compliment has no show. Flattery is undeserved, whereas a compliment is what? In fact, you could put on there greatly deserved. Okay? Unbelievable. Notice some of the quotes about flattery. I thought this was interesting. He that is much flattered soon learns to flatter himself. So folks, guess what? Be careful of flattery. Okay. Oh yeah. You become that way. You know, you got to be very careful about flattery. One person said, flattery is kind of like chewing gum. It's okay to chew on it, but don't what? Don't swallow it. Flattery is, watch this next one. This is what I was telling you a while ago. Flattery is an ensnaring quality and leaves a very dangerous impression. It swells a person's imagination, entertains his fancy, and drives him to a doting upon his own person. It's a pretty powerful quote right there, folks. Watch this next one. Though they know the flatterer knows the falsehood of his own flatteries, yet they love the impostor and with both arms hug the abuser. You see, people love what? They love to be flattered. And the flatterer gets what? He gets hugged. Okay? Ooh, you're so nice. You're so pretty. What a wonderful friend you are. Oh, I just love you. Somebody comes along and tells you the truth, and guess what you do? You get ticked, don't you? And then you call your flattering friend so he can reaffirm to you that you're what? You're great as you thought you are. Sad, isn't it? It's sad. Notice this next statement. We enjoy flattery, but rebuke is often better for us, according to Proverbs 28:23. He that rebuketh a man afterwards shall find more favor than he that flattereth with the tongue. Whew. The last statement. Proverbs 20:19, the last part of that verse says this, therefore meddle not with him that flattereth with his lips. Folks, don't encircle yourself with a bunch of what? Yes men. Okay? Don't do that. You want people to what? Tell you the truth. Yeah, you know, nobody's what? Nobody's perfect. Nobody's God's gift to earth other than Jesus. You know? It's okay to compliment. Okay, as long as it's sincere, honest, you know. But we don't have to flatter people. Questions, comments? Yes, sir. Yeah, if we keep a good, honest perspective of self and who we are, absolutely. And that's hard to do sometimes. Like you say, people, you get told enough, you start believing that junk. Okay. All right, guys, thank you. Yes, ma'am.